We're back with another episode of the Better Learning Podcast. I'm really excited about our guests today. We talk about kind of the three different circles of our audience, ones that are affecting space, the school leaders, and then this one that are more of like the culture change, the people that are have inspirational messages. And Merril Hoge is here, who comes with us history as an athlete, as a commentator, author, speaker. Merril, thanks for joining.
It's my pleasure. I know we just connected within almost 48 hours, so it's nice to be on your podcast.
I know. It was quick. Yeah, we had a mutual connection, and hearing what your message is one of those main reasons why I'm like, yes, I absolutely would love to talk to him on the podcast. But before we get to that, I always like to get a little bit of history. A lot of people probably know your name. They know the history as an athlete and being on ESPN. But I want to hear, what was your educational experience like going through school?
I've never been asked that question. I went from kindergarten to college in my hometown. So I actually didn't know that you did anything outside of Pocatello, Idaho, because I never went outside of Pocatello, Idaho. But actually, when I was a kid, when I was in sixth grade, I got diagnosed with a reading disorder, which ends up being a pretty significant thing in my life. And I went to a special class every day for an hour. And I think in a perspective, like if kids go somewhere special now to work on something, you know, there's this stigma that there's something wrong. Man, I loved going there. I love getting out of class and going somewhere for a couple of reasons. One, I was learning how to read because I really couldn't read. I had a problem reading and I was cheating. That's how they caught me. Hmm. I did a parent-teacher conference and I had some really good grades. I was expecting nothing, but a quick, fast parent-teacher conference, both my parents were there. And I remember she said, "Hey, well, listen, I want to open up with, you know, Merril's been cheating." And I was like, oh, and I actually put my head under my desk. I was so embarrassed. And to her credit, she was like, you know, I think Merril needs help with reading. And she was right, because that's why I was cheating. I couldn't read and comprehend. And like going full circle, this, you know, this comes back some, say 20 years later. My career ends. A lot of people get my NFL career ended prematurely, but it didn't end because of concussion. It ended up because of improper care of the injury, which is still the problem today. It's about care. It's not the actual injury. It's how we care for it, identify it, and blah, blah, blah. Well, what we know from head trauma, there can be things if you have that can exasperate. Head trauma can, you know, make that even harder. You know, if you have depression in your family, okay, that could be an element that you deal with that somebody else doesn't deal with because it's a factor genetically in their family. Well, I had to learn how to read again. I had to start all over and learn how to read. So, you know, I'm 30 years old, reading 2-year-old books to my daughter, who's 2 years old, and she's the only one that would had the patience to listen to me. But, you know, backing up as a kid, I mean, that was a big thing for me, because once I learned how to read, because this class will teach us how to read. We got treats for doing that, right? So I love that. And by the time I left, I had a 12th grade reading level versus like the third grade reading level where I was at the time.
That's amazing. And actually, that's a really a hot topic right now is, and this is one of those things too, that I don't think really has gotten beyond the walls of like education and people that work within schools, is that there is big controversy on the way we've been teaching reading in this country. And we've known for about 20 years that the data supports a certain way of teaching, and they call it the science of reading. And we've kind of failed a lot of these kids because they don't get that intervention. And a lot of times it's diagnosed as a reading disorder, but sometimes it's just they weren't taught a way that triggers the brain to learn how to read a certain way.
Well, you know, I went through college. I thought I'd be a teacher and I was going to get into coaching. So I got a teaching certificate. So I've done the teaching side too. And I did that. I did my student teaching. And that probably challenged me more to play in the National Football League longer than anything I did. Because
why is that?
Because I had kids that were the 7th grade and 8th grade. Okay, 7th and 8th grade, they don't know if they're coming or going. Okay, I didn't know if I was coming or going. It was just a bad recipe because I was raised like this. If somebody ever said, a teacher, well, let's just call your parents. Now, you soon said that, you got my attention. Like, we're not, don't do that. You know, I'll abide by any rule that I'm breaking. I'll clean it up or I'm going to make it right. I tried that. I was good. I thought, well, I'll just hold on to that because that'll be the heavy arsenal. I'll throw that out when needed. And I won't bore you with the story, but I had some identical twins. And one of them was on the track team. The other one wasn't. But every Friday, they were both gone. So I brought them in on Monday. I said, hey, listen, I don't know which one of you is supposed to be on the track team. And I don't know which one you're supposed to be here. I just know one of you is supposed to be here and one should be on track team. So on Friday, one of you better be here. That's all I'm saying. And we're going to call your parents. All right. And as soon as I identify what's going on, next Friday comes about, both are gone again. So the next Monday I bring them in. I said, I told you what I was going to do. We're going to call your parents. And both of them said, go ahead. And I was like, oh, I was like being sucker punched. I just like, oh my gosh. Then I called them in and then I realized where our problems existed in our country. It's the front door of every home in America because the kids behaved just like the parents. There was absolutely no respect for teaching. There was no respect. I was like, listen, one of your kids is unaccounted for. That doesn't bother you. They're supposed to be in this class. That doesn't bother you. And she was trying to tell me it wasn't my responsibility. I was like, I can't be more confused by that. I'm like, what do you mean it's not my responsibility? Some kids disappear. Anyway, so I want to go back to that reading thing. You know, one thing that I had learned, see, I think there's two ways to learn. You know, there's some people that read and comprehend, and there's other people that are visual people. And I'm a visual person. You know, I'll tell you, my job at ESPN probably saved my life, quite honestly, and how it helped me recover from the head trauma I happened, because I had to do everything visually. Like, I had to watch tape and I had to watch things and learn things visually watching it. If I had to read everything and then translate it, I'd lasted 1 year at ESPN. 1 year I'd been done. So, you know, I think there's different types of learning too, different ways to learn. People learn, like, I'm a better visual learner. You give me some video and we watch the video together. Tell me a story, talk about something versus have me read it. Complete different outcome.
Yeah. And it's nice they're starting to figure that out and being able to tailor it a lot more of whether the term is, we'll call it something like student-centered learning or individualized learning, because it is. That's exactly it. Like, I'm the same way. I learned as an adult that I can listen to things really well and digest it. And if I would have known that when I was in school, I probably would have actually finished some of the books, because I can't think of many books that I finished going through school.
Well, that's a true story. Like when I was writing a book, I mean, every teacher that knows I wrote a book that I ever taught me was like, how did that happen? You know, because I'm like, I tell people my senior year on my, in my English class, I wrote the paper and I wrote because wrong. I spelled it wrong 36 times. I spelled it B-E-C-O-U-S-E. Okay. I'm like, I got a D on it. I barely passed the thing, but I'm like, you know, we didn't have spell check back then, and my spelling was atrocious. But to your point, though, instead of being a C student, I would have been a better student, too. If I could have had audio versions and listened to stuff, it would have helped me. I'd have finished a lot more things, understood things better, and then, you know, been able to function better in tests.
When were you teaching?
After my rookie year with the Steelers, after I was drafted, I finished my rookie year, and I had one semester left. And so it was actually Chuck Noll and Mr. Rooney, the chief.
Yeah.
He's the chief. The Rooneys are still owned by the Steelers. The Rooneys still own the Steelers. The chief was the grandfather. Then there's Mr. Rooney. And then Art is the grandson of the chief, who owns it now, who's the organizer now. And Chuck Noll was one of the greatest coaches in the history of the National Football League. And both of them, part of their challenge when the offseason was over were people to work on their life's work. They would talk about your life's work. It's not football. It's something else. And if education, or you hadn't finished it, or you're close to it, they encouraged you to go back and finish. And so that encouragement really, even though I had planned on doing that, that did give me the deciding factor to go back and finish and get my education, finish it up, and then I can move on.
Yeah.
Well, so I did it then. I did it then. And, you know, I was in between just finishing it and back in Pittsburgh, still getting ready for the next season, you know, so it was a bad mixture. You know, seventh and eighth graders, like I said, they don't know if they're coming or going. It couldn't be a worse It couldn't be a worse dynamic.
I just think from that seventh and eighth grader to know that you have a teacher in here who is playing in the NFL. Did they recognize it at the time?
Well, they did and they didn't. I mean, like I didn't go in there. I went in there. I wanted to go in there as a teacher, you know. Now, well, here's what did happen to me, which is unfair, which I didn't know about this. The teacher that I was student teaching with, I saw him twice. The day I got to the school and the day I left. They were never around. They left the whole class. I thought that was my responsibility. So I ran all of it. He never showed up. He took the whole semester off. I didn't know that. I didn't know that he was supposed to be around helping me. I literally saw him the day I got there and the day I left.
Yeah. That's crazy.
So I didn't. I was going on. I didn't. I wasn't being taught. Like, there's a guy with experience that could have helped me through a lot of growing pains that I had. And I just used a lot of coaching skills I had developed and seen as a player and applied them as a teacher the best I could.
Yeah. So I really want to spend a lot of time here talking more about like your message right now, because I feel like it's a message that resonates with everyone. But speaking in particular to school leaders, which we have a significant amount of school leaders, so that are at principal level, they work at districts or they're superintendents that are leading a lot of students and really becoming kind of like that focal point of the community over the last 3 years, they really have a lot of influence in what's been happening. So would you mind kind of talking through, I know it's on your hat there, of the find a way, like what's that core message that I think is important for people to hear?
The words find a way have helped me live a dream and fight to live and a lot of in between. But what they ultimately did for me, and they still do to this day, I mean, these words still light a fire when I hear them. That's why I wear it. That's why I've lived by it. They inspire action. And that action was stemmed from a goal that I had on a wall. My dad made me a cork wall in my bedroom. I pinned my goals up and I had put the goal up. I would play in the National Football League. And I call this my first moment of truth in life. And at some point, I think one of the most important things for us all to grow, all great, successful, peaceful, successful people do it. All successful businesses do it. It's one of the core principles of growing is your ability to self-evaluate. And to self-evaluate, you have to do that in the front of a mirror, the reflection of a mirror with nobody else. You're the judge and the jury. And what's important about that, because this message at the end of the day is about you're in charge. Everybody's responsible and accountable, no matter what hand you've been dealt, because nobody was dealt a perfect hand. And if we take whatever hand we were dealt, you self-evaluate. And you make commitments or you ask questions like, am I doing my part? Did I do my part? Is there more in there? And those answers are going to give you what your responsibility is. Because at the end of the day, you're in charge. Like these words, they've inspired action, but they sent me on a journey. And there's a quote that I came across on my journey and quest to play in the National Football League. And it was by Aristotle. And the quote is, we are what we repeatedly do. Therefore, excellence is not an act, but a habit. Now, there cannot be anything more true or powerful than that. And everybody who hears that right now, think about that. You are what you repeatedly do. So you're in charge. Think about that. So whatever I put in place, whatever habit I put in place, whatever goal I put in place, whatever pattern I want to establish, that's going to be my results. And that is a powerful thing that you're in charge of that. And to get people to realize that this right here, the most powerful tool you got, we'll use it to your advantage, not your disadvantage. And that is the most challenging thing for us, because at the end of the day, it comes down to, do you control your mind or does your mind control you? And that's the thing I think everybody waffles with on a daily basis. Do you let the things that other people have said to you, the odds, how hard it is, don't be disappointed, you know, it's impossible. Or do you create a mindset of, this is where I want to go, here's what I got to do, and now I got to have a relentless commitment to it. And that is every day. And I use the thing every day. I got that from Walter Payton. You know, Walter Payton was the all-time leading rusher in the National Football League at one time when he did this tape. This was said about Walter Payton. He's not the biggest, he's not the strongest, he's not the fastest. He's just the best. As a kid, that is confusing. how in the world are you the best in the National Football League, but you're not the biggest, strongest, and fastest? Well, he was asked about that one day, and I was a kid. I was watching this tape called Winning in Life that he put out. And he said, I want it more than they do. But then he said the most powerful part of that. I mean, wanting it, is that anything novel? No. I mean, everybody wants it. I mean, everybody. I mean, you said you want $1 million? Well, sure. Then if I start listing all the things you're going to have to do for it, that arm starts to go, ugh. Okay. Well, those people that can keep the hand up, and that's about a choice now. Okay. This is not about like a gift, you know, or a genetic gift. This is a choice that everybody has. Are you going to be relentless every day? Are you going to take whatever action or things you need to do every day? Now, at the end of that journey, that's why when I talk about self-reflecting, when you can open yourself up and say, I did my part. Well, wherever you ended up, have peace with that. Does it mean you're going to be all-time leading rusher in the NFL? Could be. And if it is, awesome. If it isn't, but you did your part, wherever that is, have peace with that. And try to get people to, I think that's one of the most gratifying feelings individually, is when you can look in front of a mirror and go, man, I did my part. Like, I did everything possible. I went after it. And have peace with that. You know, it's getting people to that point and helping them with that point. And that's what the message is about. It's not about me. You know, in fact, when I get done speaking, when I hear people start reflecting on them, what they can do, how they can do it, what they're thinking now, I'm like, oh my gosh, that's what it's about. Because I'm a product of so many people. Had I not read the Aristotle quote, had I not seen Walter Payton, had I not come across a Chuck Noll, had I met all the, you know, those are just a few people of the many that impacted me. But if I didn't have that hope from those people and applied it to my life, I probably wouldn't have been, I'd probably not have gone as far as I've gone. And so I try to vision that you can help somebody get a little further, find a little more in them. They can see things a little differently, or they're like, you know what? I never thought of it that way. You know, maybe I can. And then they look at themselves and then they start making some changes. And then the next thing they'll, you know, the journey takes them somewhere they never dreamed of. Rather, you accomplish that goal or you experience something now that you never would have had you not gone after it. So I've never failed. I mean, does that mean I've accomplished my goal? Absolutely not. But I've experienced things now that I would never have had I not gone down that road. And to get people to realize that and reflect on that, that's what the message for. And that's what it's about, is getting people to feel those ways and realize they're in charge and then take the proper steps and action towards that.
Yeah, you're hitting so many things in there. I'm going to pull out one. Walter Payton was my, as a kid growing up in Chicago in the 80s,
okay.
Like.
Oh, okay. Well, then, like, that's it.
Yeah, he was one of those where, you know, and the piece that's always so powerful about Walter Payton, too, is that he did it his way and he did it with a smile on his face, like, all the time. And you're right. I think that's why it was so relatable. It's like, he wasn't the biggest. He wasn't the fastest. He wasn't the strongest. He just, he had that desire.
Just the best.
Yeah. The story that I always tell about him is that what I remember about him as a player is you would go and you would see him tackled and you'd see kind of, you know, pile of three or four players up. And then you would see this arm reaching out with the ball and just always placing it out like another yard ahead. And
every play.
Yeah. He wasn't running out of bounds. He was always leading with a shoulder to get in there. So, So when I hear you talk about him, it embodies the way he approached things. But I want to dig into a little bit more of like how, like where you talk about kind of the mentors and the people that were pushing you, for the school leaders that are out there. We're a really big component of having a group of your peers, like a confidential group of your peers, to be able to let you look at that self-discovery and push you and be able to learn from others' experiences and be able to do that in a really trusted, confidential way. Because a lot of times it's, you know, you're lonely in those roles. And, you know, you may be leading, you know, being a superintendent of a community, but you can't talk to sometimes like your friends or your staff or your spouse about certain things. And most of the people that are at those levels, because they're driven and they were driven to be successful. From your experiences, like, talk about like those people around you. Obviously, like, athletes always have coaches and they always, how much does that matter to you? And you've talked about a few of them, but what does that look like of having those people around you to help you become the best version of yourself?
Well, I say this all the time. I'm a product of a lot of people, you know, people who have challenged me, people who have inspired me. I find hope in people. You can find it in different ways. You know, I've mentioned Aristotle and Chuck Noll and Walter Payton. But, you know, I take a high school coach I had, Dirk Cutter, even though Dirk went on to coach in the National Football League. You know, he was my high school coach at one point, and he was a great listener. He would listen. And I think, you know, from leadership roles, some of the most important aspects, because I think the greatest leadership role on planet Earth, regardless of the company you run, a superintendent, whatever school you're in charge of, if you have kids, it's being a parent. That is your greatest leadership role that you will ever have. And investing in our kids and being involved in our kids and helping them develop in good human beings is the greatest thing that we can ever do. I mentioned student teaching, and that was more evident there than in any environment I've ever been in, and when they're failing at the home, you know, and you can see that. So what a teacher or a coach, and really a coach is a teacher, because I've coached too. I've run camps for almost 20 years, you know, from ages 8 to 18. So I've coached thousands and thousands of kids. I see things through a child's eyes more than most adults because of the things that happened to me as a kid. I give this is a parenting tool. It turned into a coaching tool and even a business tool, but it started as a parenting tool. But it's a good thing. I use it as a teacher. I judge my kids in the yardsticks of their years and not mine. It's given me two things at all times: patience and perspective. And so, you know, when I talked about those seventh and eight-year-old, or the seventh graders and eighth graders, I wasn't a parent at that time. I didn't have that perspective. I didn't have that tool at that time. I really didn't exercise or develop it until I became a parent. And I go back and reflect on how I went about teaching and coaching. I was a much different coach and teacher at that time versus when I had kids. And then I started to apply that rule. And, you know, and to answer your question, I just think I find hope in so many different scenarios. Doesn't mean you always succeed in that environment, but you learn from that environment so that you don't keep passing it on. That's why I go back to self-reflecting. I don't know of any superintendent, I don't know of any principal, when they just get that job for the very first time, that they know everything. I mean, part of being a good principal and a superintendent or a good teacher is you learn and evolve. You know, I mean, just because you become the teacher of a class doesn't mean you know how to really teach. I mean, especially if it's your first year here, you know, you're going to be a lot better over time. And I learned that actually from the principals of the Rooneys. You know, there's been three coaches here in over 60 years.
Yeah, and that's crazy. From
Chuck Noll, Bill Cowher, and now Mike Tomlin. But their overall philosophy, if people understood it, every one of these coaches were hired as young coaches and never had a head coaching job before. They knew that. They also knew they didn't know how to be a head coach, but they felt they had the right person. So give them time to learn how to be a head coach. Let them learn from their mistakes, evolve and grow and become two great head coaches, which has happened three times. Two Hall of Famers already. You probably have a third. So, you know, sports are, I just think they're a great analogy for classrooms, for teaching and evolving young people when we're trying to work with them. How you look at yourself, you know, superintendents. I mean, I go back and think about me as a teacher back then and what my thought process was there. I used all the experiences that I ever had a teacher put on me that influenced me. Now, today, it wouldn't be the best. It wouldn't be the way I would teach. You know, that yardsticks of their years, not mine. See, patience and perspective. You know, a kid is 12 years old doing 12-year-old things. And you see that you're 42, you know, it's easy to see it as a 42-year-old, not a 12-year-old. Mm-hmm. And now as they got older, my kids got older, even kids I coached, at some point they get an age, and I just made an age that this would be applicable for them. I asked them to look at me in the yardsticks of my years and not theirs. I tried to open their scope and go, hey, listen, I'm 42. I've been in this classroom. I've been a seventh, an eighth grader and ninth grader, high school, college. Okay, I've done all of this. I've lived all of it. And get them to understand, okay, and what I'm trying to do is help you through your journey and make less mistakes than I made. But communicating that is often not made. You know, it's never expressed. And once I started to do that with younger kids, I did it as I coached. The bridge that I would create with my students and my kids was just so much better. You know, you get this important aspect of learning. You learn more by listening than you ever learn by talking. And when the two will listen and the communication bridge is applied, so you listen, you can communicate, you can talk, and you can listen, is when really great things happen on both ends. And once I started to apply that, as I started to evolve as a coach and a teacher, it just, the way we grew together was just so much better.
And it sounds like that's a lesson that's continued today, just, you know, as you're doing more and more speaking engagements and doing that, it sounds like you're still continuing to just like get better and surround yourself, just from what little I know about you from our mutual connection.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, I talk about self-evaluation. How do you grow? Okay. Well, I've been speaking technically for 15 years, but I've kind of done that in between my career at ESPN. And then one day I looked at myself, I'm like, wait, I was working towards going all in and speaking anyway. And one day I was like, wait a minute, like, you don't even know anything about speaking. Like, really, you don't know anything about it. And I was talking to my publisher right after I'd written this book. And he said, well, you ought to go to a boot camp. Okay, who wants to go to a boot camp? You know, a boot camp is where, you know, most boot camps, you know, are, you're starting over, you're learning all this stuff. And I think there's a tendency to think, if you've been doing it for 15 years, I'm good enough and I know enough. And I'm like, well, that's exactly what you speak on. No, you don't. You know, you don't know what you don't know. And there was a lot of things I didn't know. Because when I went to this boot camp, that was the first thing they asked me, go, why you come? Why'd you come? They ask everybody, why'd you come? And I said, I don't know. I don't know what I don't know. And I'm hoping that when I leave here, I'll know what I don't know. And when I left, I knew what I didn't know, which was a lot.
Yeah.
And I'm grateful for that, because now I'm having to regroup, evolve, change, grow. And it's been refreshing. It's been awesome to learn it. And it's helped me get to where I want to go. If I would have said, yeah, nah, I don't need that. I've been speaking 15 years. I'm good. I will never reach the potential that I have a chance of reaching had I not done that.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's powerful right there to everyone who feels like they've had success and there's that other level that he can do. And it is about trying to find whether that group, that knowledge, the people that are going to help support and help that grow. So yeah.
Cause it's okay. It's okay to open your mind into things and listen to somebody. Even if you're like, okay, I ain't going to like this. This ain't applying to me. Just for 1 second, listen to it. Cause you can still go, you know what? That's not for me. It's okay to do that. But at least you give it a fair. I'll give you an example. A good friend of mine, he wants to start becoming vegan. I'm like, vegan? I'm like, what the? And okay. And I'm like, wait a minute. I'm killing vegan. I know nothing about vegan. So I'm like, you know what? Heck yeah. I'm going to try one for six. I'm going to go. I do blood work every 6 months, right? So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to do vegan. My wife and I say, well, let's do it for 6 months. Okay. And it was hard. Like, it was like, you go out to eat, you're like, holy cow. Like, the hardest part was trying to find, you know, foods when you went out and ate that you could structure under vegan. But we do it for 6 months. And I do it from blood work to blood work. And it really did nothing for me. And then, but it did open this up. I'm like, you know, really, when I look at how my structure is from a nutrition aspect, I don't just have, you know, a side of beef every night. You know, do I have a steak? Sure do. I love it. But I might have one every 10 days and I might have some back to back. And then I can eat fish for 3 days and I can eat chicken for a day. And then sometimes I have meat at all. I'm like, that balance and the avoiding of sugar is a bigger factor for me, not overeating at meals, how I'd structured a lifestyle that worked for me. Doesn't mean vegan isn't good, because there's some people who can't have actual steak or meat because of a genetic issue they have. And so they have to live like that and they live better like that. And just open my eyes to it completely different than versus saying, it's stupid. I don't like it. Now I understand it. I tried it. It wasn't for me, but doesn't mean it's not for people, especially with genetic issues, that need it.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a great example of it. So I'm going to go one more topic here before I let you go here and respect your time. And I hope I don't get you in trouble with this question here, but I think we talk about it, like the goal of our podcast and really all our work is to improve education in this country. And leadership is one of the biggest things we can do. We also are affiliated with a group that they physically, they're the architects of schools, and they design buildings and spaces to try to accommodate the best type of learning outcomes from that. But there's a third circle that I think is we're ignoring from in there of like, we're not having discussions with the general public about like the perception of what school and what schools look like and what education looks like. So I'd love to kind of hear your take of like, where do you think the direction of school is right now? Do you think we're, from your impression of not like going to a school campus every day, do you feel like we're going on the right track? Do you feel like there's things that are wrong? Like, what's kind of your general sense of where, what the public feels about?
I'll use the area where I grew up. My kids grew up in Fort Thomas, Kentucky, just outside Cincinnati. We're like 5 minutes from downtown Cincinnati, but if I brought you there, blindfolded you, and I'm like, how far do you think the nearest city is? You'd be like, miles away. Maybe not even, okay, and it's 5 minutes away, but it's like Mayberry.
Yeah, and familiar. I actually lived right across the river for a little bit in Mount Lookout, Cincinnati.
Okay, yeah. You know all about it. So here's what I do believe in, and have been, even though I was a student teacher, I believe this. I think that there are things that the schools are responsible for, and that's what a school was structured for. And that's helping kids read, write, and then arithmetic, some of the structures, things I think they could do better. I mean, not that this is for grade school, but I think junior high school is applicable. We don't teach enough about, you know, just really life skills, like a checkbook. I mean, finance, and just some real structural things in life that have to be functional. And then I'll just throw under the personal category. I don't think school has any business in a personal responsibility. That's in the home. Now I'm teaching, but I sat in that environment. I would feel very uncomfortable talking about things that are that I have personal conversation with my daughter or my son, having it with kids that are not my daughter or not my son at an age that is way beyond appropriate. And having somebody like me talking to their kids. I think that is for the mom and the dad and the parents in that home. I'm under the structure of what I thought school was for, and that is to help them educate, grow, and learn from a reading, writing, and arithmetic perspective. Do I think we could add a little more, like I mentioned, just some of the other basic things in life that are tools that you're going to have to learn? Because I was 21 years old. I got drafted by the Steelers. I showed up. I signed my contract. I got my signing bonus. And they said, well, you might want to put that in your checking account. I said, my what? I didn't have a checking account. I didn't even know what a checking account was. I'd heard of a checking account because my parents had a checking account. My parents told me nothing about a checking account. Somebody could say, well, your parents can do that too. I don't think there's any doubt. Parents could do that too. However, those tools, everybody needs. I get like, you're going to have function under some type of financing. Credit cards. What are credit cards really for? How used improperly, how they can bury you and handcuff you and put you in financial prison forever. You know, there's all kinds of things I think that could be added to the curriculum that'll be a much more productive thing for life skills than the personal aspect of stuff. Personal aspects, though, I believe belongs in the home, stays in the home, and that should be taught in the home, not in the school environment.
Yeah, now, I appreciate you sharing that, because I think that's a little bit of like the cultural battle that's going on in a lot of communities right now is where is that line? And I feel like the schools have been asked, almost to your example of like, you know, when you were student teaching, of like, you would expect the parents like wanting to enforce like that the kid was not where they were supposed to be. They feel like that line has been pushed over into the education side of like, no, you're not in charge of just teaching knowledge. You're also in charge of nutrition and make sure they're fed and everything else that, you know, that's really tough to figure out. Where is that line of how much should be taught in school versus in the household? And, you know,
being a parent, I don't want a school telling my kids, teaching my kids those things. That's why I go back to, I just think parenting is the greatest leadership role you'll ever have when you have kids. And I don't care how important you think you are in your company. You might be the CEO of a Fortune 500 company. And if you're failing your kids, but you have a successful company, do you really sleep at night?
Yeah.
Do you really sleep at night?
Yeah.
You know, that's just my, and I've experienced it from not just a parent, but I've taught, I've coached, I've literally been impactful. And like, I can't tell you how many thousands of kids' lives from 8 to 18. And what my role is as a coach and a teacher, I've never felt that I had the right to go outside that arena other than an arena that you have can be impactful alone in developing young people to believe in themselves, work through. I don't know if you in this group, and it's probably apropos because have you ever heard of ACEs?
Sure. Yep.
Okay. So adverse childhood experiences, you know, that is that's a real powerful thing. And what we find is that, and the reason I identify with it because I had a bunch of ACEs, but I really remember it when my mom died at a young age and I was young, and what it did to me and what it did to our home, how it wrecked our home and just the effects of that. And then what were the things that stabilized me or I leaned on to get me through it? Had I not had football and in sports, I don't know what I would have done. You know, I'm telling you, I do not know what I would have done. It was my sanctuary, it was my 3 hours of peace. And had I not, and I've seen sports do that for so many kids. I've had so many kids. My son come home with a friend one day and they were talking about what they were going to do. And this is like fifth, sixth grade. And he says, well, I'm going to probably be a bum like my dad. Like that. And his dad was working every odd job you could, trying to provide for the family. The mom had left the home. He's coming home to an empty home with his sister that's a year older than him. And he's like, you know, Bo was telling me the story. And I was like, Bo, you know what? Does he want to play football? So I asked him to play football. The next day he goes, I can't play. Well, the reason he couldn't play, he couldn't afford shoes. So I was like, well, listen, we'll take care of that. This is when Reebok was going. I had friends at Reebok. So I had Reebok send me shoes for all my kids because I wasn't going to make this kid feel, oh, he's different and make everybody get new shoes. They equipped us. We brought him in. This kid changes his life with sports. And I helped him with it. I pulled him aside. And listen, after practice for 2 days, I was like, oh my gosh, this kid's gifted. So I told him, I go, listen, you have a chance to do something with this sport. Not playing the NFL. I'm not worried about that. You have a chance to get an education. Yeah, that's how good you are. If you stay with this, well, what happens? I see his dad start showing up, bringing his sister. Well, he ends up leaving us after a couple of years, but my nephew goes to Notre Dame. When I go to see him in his freshman class, part of that freshman class was the linebacker, the kid that my son had brought to that camp. But now it's one experience. I have thousands of them. How we can help people through the sports are a great avenue for that and helping that. I didn't feel like I needed to get into their personal life. If you can give them hope, that's why I believe in people. I find hope in people. And that I believe was within the scope of what I was supposed to do. To go outside of that, I would have felt uncomfortable and I would not have felt it was my way, but I found a way to help him, give him an avenue and a channel. Yeah. And he's the one that had to do it ultimately, which he did. And it's a great story. There's thousands of them that exist out there like that. And I'd rather focus on those things and feed those things because that is value and those proven. And that is the proper and valuable things to give people to build resiliency and work through those ACEs that they've had in their life and fix themselves where they wouldn't have had any other option.
Yeah. And I think you hit it too, that there's a lot of talk within education. There's just got to be at least one adult in kids' life where when they come there that they know somebody cares about them. And whether it's from sports, from coaching, it's obviously a really, you know, like it is a great one that's really relatable and kind of out there. But it's just like having that one connection. So somebody knows that they care about them, you know, for whether, you know, they have the support at home or not.
So, very true. I mean, I've seen it so many times, you know, without knowing all, I mean, nobody knows the true story if you're not behind, if you don't open that front door and live in it. You just can't, you know. You can anticipate, you can speculate. That's not going to do you any good. But the one thing that I have learned from when you do know that it's not the best environment is to find an environment that gives them hope or they have a sanctuary to come to where they now see the difference, you know. And then I go to the kid. The kid made the choice. I mean, he ultimately made the choice. I didn't. I mean, he left, went to Indiana, and after a couple of years, my son stayed in touch with him, and he was a beast. I mean, he was one of the top linebackers in the country, and, you know, ended up going to Notre Dame, and he got his education. You know, that's the one thing that he went for. And had he not, though, had he not gone down that road, who knows? Right. I just know this. It wouldn't have been good. More than likely, it wouldn't have been good because, you know, he was going in the wrong direction. And I guess, you know, miracles can happen, but the odds are it wasn't going to end good.
Yeah. Well, Merril, I really appreciate your time and talking through this. I think your passion comes through. And just for the people who maybe are not familiar with all your story, I really recommend going to Merril Hoge. It's really your website, merrillhoge.com. I mean, you have a bunch of different examples of kind of speaking and messages that, so to the audience out there, if you're planning anything and just want to get a perspective that's really has gone through, you know, like a lot of adversity and overcoming obstacles, it's really cool to hear your story and the way you present it. So I appreciate your time. And to the audience too, if you have not already subscribed to the podcast, just hit subscribe wherever you're listening, but also go to betterlearningpodcast.com. We have a quick survey on there too, that just will help kind of align people's kind of gifts and interests with ways that we can improve education together. So, Merril, thank you so much. It was great talking to you.
My pleasure. I sure enjoyed it. Thanks for having me.
The views and opinions expressed on the Better Learning Podcast are those of myself as an individual and my guests, and do not necessarily represent the organizations that we work for, the Association for Learning Environments, K-12, Education Leaders Organization, or Second Class Foundation.